Hi everybody, Ken Hsieh here, the music director of the Vancouver Metropolitan Orchestra. We're definitely living through some very unusual times, and as the numbers have spiked, I really hope that you guys are all well and safe in your very own homes, and for those of you who are going to work are taking extra precaution. The orchestra hasn't been able to perform together since last March. However, we are able to be in the Chan Center this time with the woodwind group and with the brass group. And today I am here with the brass group to lead them and lead you through a beautiful concert called VMO Brass Through the Ages. And so today I am joined here by two of my great friends, trumpeter Mark D'Angelo and trombonist Jim Hopson. I'm here with two of my favorite brass players from my orchestra. I have here Mark D'Angelo, who plays the trumpet, and Jim Hopson, who plays the trombone. And you guys have been with the orchestra for quite a long time, actually. And today, I really want to thank you guys, because you guys actually not only played so beautifully, but you guys were instrumental in helping me design the program tonight. And so Jim, what was the, because you both actually came up with this together, and I really didn't have any part, but tell us about your idea of this VMO's Brass Through the Ages.
So,
how did you come up with that?
Yeah, so I just remember, the way I remember it is we were on a Zoom call together. We got together on a Zoom call, a three-way Zoom call, just to discuss like repertoire that we wanted to play. And I think what we found in the Zoom call was that like we have a lot of really varied musical interests. Mm-hmm. You know, like I'm a jazz trombonist as well as playing the orchestra.
Yeah.
Mark plays a lot of commercial music and Latin music, and we have and Ken, you're a musical omnivore yourself, right? and you know, brass instruments have been around, you know, kind of in their current form for hundreds and hundreds of years. There's a long storied history, mm-hmm. and we were kind of thinking, well, how can we get all these different pieces to sit together on the same program? And I think so that the idea that we came up with was Brass Through the Ages.
And that, I thought it was a really fitting title because, you know, we have basically music from literally almost every era. I mean, coming almost from that, between the Renaissance, Baroque, all the way until, until Jim Hopson's own piece, right?
Exactly.
So, I mean, I'm coming all the way into
like a month ago.
Yeah, a month ago. So, yeah, and so today, I just wanted to start it the order a little differently, if you guys don't mind, but I thought that the first piece that we played and recorded today was actually a piece that was normally written for string by Handel, mm-hmm. and this is the arrival of Queen Sheba, and I think it's such a very recognizable piece. And so, Mark, tell us a little bit about this Handel, the arrival of Queen of Sheba.
Oh, we all know the piece, the arrival of Sheba, and it's really kind of a majestic piece that's, you know, built on a lot of arpeggios.
Yes.
And and which for the trumpet and well, brass instruments in general is not the most natural thing to do.
Yeah.
But it works really well. There's so much great music for brass by Handel in particular. He's one of the early composers that really, especially for the trumpet, mm-hmm. Really featured the trumpet a lot in his works, even though this is not one of those particular works. So it seems to fit really well. And for me, getting to play the piccolo trumpet on this one was a real joy because of the soloistic nature. And I really like this arrangement too, how it's how it kind of separates into different sections. There are two trumpets, flugelhorns on their own.
Yeah.
There are two trumpets on their own. There are smaller groups of brass that are playing individual things, and it comes together different textures, more mellow textures, and then the piccolo trumpet, which is kind of like the cherry on the top, so to speak. Plays the violin role a little bit in that ensemble. So it's really really interesting arrangement, really cool piece, and it's a lot of fun to play, for sure.
Sounds great. Well, here it is. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is Handel's The Arrival Queen of Sheba. Enjoy. All right, so we just heard the really beautiful Handel, the arrival of Queen of Sheba. I think that was a fantastic opening to this concert. So, Jim, our next piece is actually a piece that kind of going back in time now, and this is Gabrieli's. I gotta get you to say the name. What is it exactly?
So, Canzon a Duodecimi Toni.
Your Italian is very good.
Oh, Mark's the Italian here. We'll have him say it later. I'm sure it's way better than mine. But yeah, so it's a great example of Renaissance era brass music. And of course, back in the Renaissance, we did have instruments that were trumpets and trombones of sorts. It's actually written for cornettos, which are these instruments that almost look like woodwind instruments. They have holes like a woodwind instrument would have, like a recorder, but they're played on a brass instrument mouthpiece.
Oh, no way.
So those would have been covering the trumpet parts, and they're a very light kind of vocal sound. And then the trombone back then was referred to as the sackbut, the Renaissance trombone, which had a much smaller bell and was generally a lighter, more vocal sounding instrument. And these sort of antiphonal choir compositions, like the Gabrieli that we're playing, were usually played in churches. And I'm going to let Mark take over from here.
Yeah, Mike.
Well, it's kind of appropriate now in the time of COVID-19 that we're playing this music, because this is the original social distancing music.
Oh, wow.
Here. St. Mark's Basilica in Venice is where Gabrieli spent most of his time.
Okay.
And this composition in particular, it was designed for antiphonal choirs. So I believe, I've been there once, I believe there are four balconies, at least four, maybe more, choir lofts so to speak, in the cathedral there. And what they would do is they would position different groups of brass players at different points in the cathedral, and you'd have this antiphonal effect where like basically stereophonic.
Choir one and a kind of choir two.
Choir one, choir two. Yeah. And often it was very interesting because Gabrieli was one of the first composers, if not the first composer, to actually write dynamics in the part. They didn't have like crescendos and diminuendos that we see in modern music. Mm-hmm. But they have what we call terrace dynamics. So they would have piano and forte. So they'd have a loud choir, a soft choir.
Yes.
There's no brass concert without at least a little bit of Gabrieli on it.
That's
so
great.
For sure.
So here it is. And I didn't get to conduct this piece, but I hope you all enjoy working with my very young assistant conductor, Camille Wong. And Camille, I believe, is a very young, talented, very emerging, and very serious conductor. I mean, he's really knowledgeable, and I think in many times more knowledgeable than me, you know. So, but I think and you guys, I think, were so receptive to him, and I think it really evidently showed. So here it is, little Gabrieli's Canzon.
I'll give it to Mark this time.
The proper Italian.
Give it to the Italian here.
Canzona Duodecimi Toni.
There we go. Please enjoy. So, anyway, that was Camille Wong conducting our fabulous brass section, the Tentet. But our next piece is a favorite of mine when I play at home by myself. And this is the piano sonata, better known as the Pathétique. And I believe that was the title that was given. And Jim, you were instrumental in arranging this. And tell us about this inspiration, and why did you choose to arrange this piece? Sure.
Well, like you, Maestro, you know, growing up, this is one of my favorite pieces of maybe early Romantic music, and I'm not a pianist in any way, but I'm definitely an appreciator of Beethoven in particular. Mm-hmm. I think he wrote this piece when he was about 27.
Very young. Yeah.
And in his lifetime, this was actually, in a lot of ways, this is maybe one of his most popular works.
It is.
In his own lifetime. It kind of put him on the map a little bit, mm-hmm. in some ways. And this arrangement, I actually wrote the initial arrangement for this when I was in university, when I was at UVic.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and it just sat in my hard drive. It never got played. It sat in my hard drive for probably a dozen years before coronavirus. And so I ransacked my hard drive just to find all these different things I'd written over the years, and this is one that popped out. I was like, oh, I wrote this when I was in college, but it actually is pretty good. So adapted it and got it published this year, and this is actually, I think, the first recorded performance of that arrangement.
Fantastic.
And I think it really features the lyrical side of exactly. a lot of our brass players. It's written for quintet, but mm-hmm. we did it as a sort of a double quintet,
yeah.
For a more lush sound, and I thought it turned out extremely well.
So. I thought it was a beautifully transcribed piece because I remember being in university, and one of our homework assignments was to arrange a Beethoven sonata into maybe like a string quartet or into a wind ensemble or something. But what I really thought was that this piece really brought out, like you said, the lyrical trumpet side, you know, and I thought it brought different colors of this piece that probably Beethoven couldn't have imagined, and I thought it was really beautiful. What's your take on it, Mike?
Yeah, no, I agree. It's definitely interesting to hear, and just the different characters of the different instruments. Like you listen even just at the beginning to the French horn solo,
mm-hmm. In the very beginning, right?
Having it in that instrument, just the mellow nature of the French horn, one of the many natures of the French horn, but mellow, beautiful, warm, conical yeah. sound definitely brings a different feel that you might not hear on a piano. I mean, you have the sustain pedal and you're able to do yeah. the soft stuff on the piano, but definitely the tone quality that we're able to bring there is very very neat to hear.
Yeah, I got to admit, because when I conducted this piece, and now we're conducting, I know this piece very well because I played it when I was young. But I have to admit, when I was conducting, I actually had my fingers moving like a piano player, you know, because I want to know where I really take the rubatos and where I take the, and so it was very meaningful for me, this performance. So here it is. Let's have a listen to it. So this is Beethoven's piano sonata, and this is the second movement from the Pathetic sonata, and this is arranged by our very own Jim Hopson. So please enjoy. All right, so Jim, really fantastic arrangement of this beautiful Beethoven. I mean, that was for me, how do you say, a little bit deja vu into going to my youth, you know. And so now we're going to come to a piece that I really wanted to conduct, but I actually assigned this piece to Camille, my assistant conductor, and this is Paul Dukas, Fanfare à la Paris. So Jim, why don't you tell us a bit about it?
So the first thing I would say is the full title of the piece is Fanfare pour précéder la Paris. So that just means in French, it's a fanfare to come before the ballet, right? To be honest, Mark is the one who suggested programming this. And I think he knows a lot more about the piece than I do.
So why did you choose to come up with this piece?
Well, actually, I love Paul Dukas in
well, I mean, I love conducting his Sorcerer's Apprentice. Well,
that's probably one of his most well-known works.
Oh, yeah, of course, and, you know. And yeah.
I love French music, and actually, I was exposed to this at a very young age. This was the first piece that I had ever seen in my entire life written for C trumpet. But it's a beautiful piece, and one thing I really love about it is I love kind of this music from this period in France at the time, this kind of impressionistic music. Some of my favorite
composers. Yeah, it's a change in time, I think.
I love Debussy as well. It's one of my favorite. Just the choices of chords that he uses, where you get that kind of unstable feeling, but where you're not being pulled in any specific direction by the harmony. Mm-hmm. I really love that, and also just the style too. Paul Dukas was a composition teacher, believe it or not, at the Paris Conservatoire.
Yes, he was. Yes.
And there's a lot of amazing music happening in that period, and for trumpet especially, kind of the heyday, you know, in some respects of our technique and our solo repertoire came from that period in France.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the pieces that young students will recognize, like Eugene Botz was around the same period or a little bit after, was a student there. You know, all these composers composing in that period for trumpet, specifically the C trumpet, came from that time. So that's why I chose this piece in particular. I really love it. And it's not something you see performed too often.
It's a great piece. I mean, for me, I thought, wow, you know, it's just, you want to make a big statement. That's the piece you want to make it with, right? Mm-hmm. So, well, here it is. So this is Paul Dukas, Fanfare à la Paris. Please enjoy. Thank you. All right, so that was Fanfare à la Paris by Paul Dukas, conducted by Camille Wong, with our, of course, fabulous VMO brass section. And so now we come to a very unique piece, and I had a great time conducting this piece, and I really wanted to conduct it. And in front of me, you see one of the most unique instruments.
Oh, I didn't probably even notice. Oh, where did this come?
But it's an Alphorn, and I remembered I forgot the name, the term of this actual instrument. And so when you guys mentioned, oh, we should do the Alphorn ballade, and I'm like, what Alphorn? And then Jim was great on the Zoom call. He go, wow, Ken, I am actually a very known, renowned Alphorn player in town. So, you know, this is a great piece. And I'm like, Jim, I would love to do something like this. So, Jim, tell us about this unique instrument we have here.
So this is an Alphorn, and it's a folk instrument from mostly Switzerland, but also parts of southern France and Germany in the Alpine regions. And it has a history going back about 2,000 years in that region. There's actually records of like old woodcuts almost back from Roman times of instruments like this. And historically, it was a farmer or a shepherd's instrument used for communication. Uh-huh. When you play these outdoors, especially in the mountains where you can bounce your sound off a cliff face, the sound will actually carry several kilometers.
Oh wow!
So of course, in a country like Switzerland or again parts of southern France, where you have these little towns in the valleys separated by these long mountain passes, well, if you want to communicate to the next village over, you can either strap on all your winter gear and hike through the snow for several kilometers at great personal risk, or you can get the Alphorn out and blow a call on the Alphorn. And historically, they did have different calls which meant different things. Oh, there's a wolf here, avalanche in the area, things like that. Historically, these instruments were made out of you'd find a tree growing in roughly this shape coming out of side of the mountain, and you'd carve it out of one piece. Of course, this one is actually made in several pieces. So I've actually toured all over the world with this thing, four continents with this thing.
And I noticed that when you blow in, are you using a mouthpiece that's very similar to the brass? Or
it is, yeah. It's a mouthpiece. It's a cup-shaped mouthpiece, just like a trumpet or a trombone mouthpiece. The same, and it's the same technique for playing one. Very similar technique.
Yeah.
Being a trombonist, I use something that's, you know, closer in shape and size to a smallish trombone mouthpiece.
Yeah.
But a lot of different players use trumpet size or French horn size mouthpieces on these well.
Well, here it is, the Alphorn Ballade, with featuring our very own Jim Hopson, and please enjoy. Mm-hmm. All right, so that was Alphorn Ballade featuring our very own Jim Hopson. Well, we're going to go on to now a favorite piece of mine, because this is something I wanted to do, and I think for any of you brass players, and John Williams is just one of the icons of movie music. And so one of the pieces I really wanted to do, because unfortunately with COVID-19, I still wanted to keep the Olympic sort of dream alive, because we didn't have the Olympics in Tokyo this year. And so they postponed the Olympic to next year. But just to keep it alive, I thought it would be great to do the Olympic fanfare. And this is a great piece. So Mark, I mean, tell us about this beautiful piece.
Yeah, sure. I remember discussing with this you, because you were supposed to be in Japan during the Olympics, weren't you? And that's part of the reason why you wanted to do this piece in particular. And obviously, like you're mentioning, John Williams is one of the one of my favorite composers for brass music, of course. And mm-hmm. I'm sure many composers and musicians have the same feeling about him.
Yeah.
So this piece, the Olympic Fanfare, is really, really neat piece. And it was written for the 1984 Olympic Games in, I believe it was Los Angeles, was it?
Yeah. Which actually happened.
Yeah, which actually happened. this is a really, really cool fanfare. It's got a lot of drama. It's got really interesting passages for all instruments and encompasses different melodies and percussion. And
speaking of percussion, this is actually the first piece that I think that we have percussion featured, if I'm not mistaken.
There's a drum set in the Armitage.
A drum set in the Alphorn, yes, of course. But I think a real, featured, because I think, as you guys said, he was so instrumental for the brass, but his percussion writing, because I was a percussionist too when I was young, and it was just so much fun to play, but it was challenging, His stuff is not easy. It's so pleasing on the ear, but, I remember conducting Harry Potter music, and the string players, by the time they finished, they were all sweating, and they were just ready to go take a nap. Mm-hmm. Jim, tell us about your experience with John Williams' music.
Well, first of all, I think, speaking of the percussion, we should throw a shout out to a wonderful percussionist, Brian Nesselrode, who did a great job of covering the really heavy percussion writing.
Yes.
On that John Williams as one person. That's a tough gig.
That's a tough gig for sure. Yeah.
As a person who's also a composer, a big part of my appreciation for John Williams is his ability to write an earworm, is to write a melody that you go home singing at the end of the night.
I know, it sticks with you, doesn't it?
Indiana Jones, bum, bum, bum.
Yeah.
The music is as memorable as the movie that he writes it in. And I think this Olympic fanfare is the same thing. I mean, I know after the recording session that we did, this was the tune I had in my head on the way home.
Stuck in your head forever, isn't it? Yeah. Well, here it is. This is the piece that I really wanted to conduct for this concert. This is John Williams' Olympic Fanfare. Enjoy.
Thank you.
All right. Well, you know what? Fabulous job, guys. I really enjoyed that take of Olympic Fanfare because I could see that spirit that, you know, and that's what I really wanted to achieve with that Olympic, you know, fanfare spirit that, you know, it didn't happen, but, you know, hopefully next year the Tokyo could have this Olympics. Now we go on to something that's fun, and this is a piece I it was so bossa nova, but by Quincy Jones. But I wanted my assistant to conduct this piece because I wanted to see him get loose, you know, and kind of free, you know, and not conducting the usual, like very strict kind of how do you say conducting for like Beethoven or anything, you know. Mm-hmm. And so, Jim, tell us about this Soul Bossa Nova by Quincy Jones.
So, if you've ever seen the Austin Powers
yes.
series of movies featuring Mike Myers, of course, a Canadian as well,
yes.
right? You will recognize this song. This is the theme song mm-hmm. to that whole franchise, written by the great Quincy Jones. For those of you who might not be familiar with Quincy Jones, if you are alive in the late 20th century, early 21st century, you've heard his music. He did a lot of production work for Michael Jackson. As a jazz composer, he wrote a lot of really, really, really famous tunes as well. He was a jazz trumpet player, which was his original origin, but definitely morphed into a producer-composer. Again, a composer with the gift of melody.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, this is an earworm, again.
Mm-hmm.
But tweet-a-doo-da. You know,
I just wanted to snap my finger in that piece, you know, because it's just so snappy at the same time. And
this is the thing with brass players too, is that if you've ever had a conversation with brass players, you'll know that we try not to take ourselves too seriously. We like to have fun, and we wanted to throw this on the program just as a gift to the audience, something to break up the seriousness.
Oh, absolutely, you know? I think this whole concert was so much more relaxing because, you know, previously before that I recorded the Dvorak wind serenade with the woodwinds and cello and bass, but, you know, playing this kind of music, we have to be very disciplined and very concentrating, but this one kind of relaxes the mind. I mean, Mike, what would this be?
Yeah, it's really interesting. Like with brass, that's just a tradition a little bit with brass players. We don't take ourselves too seriously.
Yeah, I noticed that.
And you can't take yourself too seriously as a brass player when you never know what's going to come out of the bell of your instrument, and it's not always going to be good. So you have to have a jovial attitude in order to survive in this business. Yeah. So it's really became something that's kind of standard with brass players to do some lighter music.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a really good opportunity, too, to feature a couple soloists.
Absolutely,
that we have.
Yes.
We have great jazz players in this ensemble, too,
mm-hmm.
Featuring Malcolm Aiken on flugelhorn,
yes.
Which he's an amazing flugelhorn player, and Jim as well on trombone.
Exactly, yeah.
So it gives a chance for them to let loose and to blow. And this was an arrangement done by Stephen Paranosic, a trumpet player, Vancouver Island Symphony, and on the island Victoria. And I heard him; he had an ensemble that had played this, and I heard the arrangement, and I thought it was kind of a cool piece to play. And I'm a huge Quincy Jones fan as well.
I am too. I mean, the guy straight up forward, but I mean he's. But he's fantastic.
And Jim was mentioning him as a producer. He became really famous as a producer, Quincy Jones, after he had to stop playing trumpet, tragically. He was an amazing trumpet player. There's some clips you can still see of him playing. But he had a condition where he would have, not a stroke. He got admitted to the hospital, something similar to a stroke.
Mm.
And the doctor diagnosed him that he said if you kept playing the trumpet,
you could have
a serious stroke. And so he had to stop playing, and he just transitioned and migrated into being a producer and a
very
composer.
Successful one.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, Thriller's a pretty good thing to have on your resume. It's something you produced and recorded, right? So,
yeah, exactly.
Definitely a real talent for sure.
Well, here it is. This is Quincy Jones, Soul Bossa Nova. Please enjoy. One, two, one, two, three. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed that. That was Kemio Wang conducting Quincy Jones' Soul Bossa Nova. And we come to the final piece. And this is the most recently composed piece, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. And this is by our very own, again, Jim Hopson. And this piece is called Fire and Ice. And I, when you told me the title of this piece, I was thinking Fire and Ice, the movie. I know you weren't inspired by that film, but tell us about how you came up with this name, Fire and Ice.
Yeah, well, so, okay. So when I decided I was going to write something like this, well, we did that Zoom call and programmed something. And, of course, during coronavirus times, I've got a lot more time than I normally do to write things. At that time, I had just written a proposal, a sketch for a kids' TV show medieval themed, right? And it didn't end up getting picked up as the theme song, but I had all this material. I was also, at the time, it being coronavirus, binge watching Game of Thrones.
Ah.
And I had sort of these these sort of modal themes going on in my head. And I kind of use that as the source material to build this kind of video game dragon slaying, two and a half minute sort of banger of a piece. You know, I definitely, as brass players, fire is an element that we connect to a lot. You know, when somebody plays something particularly great, we say, oh, that was hot, you know.
Yeah.
Or playing something cool on a brass instrument too, like mm-hmm. Miles Davis. You can get that sort of. So I wanted to create a piece with lots of contrast in it.
Yeah.
Just like, you know, Fire and Ice would be in terms of.
Yeah. And Mark, how would you take on that piece? I mean, it's.
It's a very cool piece. I really liked it. I like his use of meter and how the piece
that 6/8 meter really got me. And it just kind of got that movement.
Yeah, you just get that feeling that it's really driving forward, right? Yeah. And
we did drive it though.
Drove it home, man.
Definitely, and it just it flies by so quick, and it's just really moving. The rhythm is very pervasive. It just pulls you along.
I thought it was a great piece written because it was. At the same time, like you said, there's melodic, and then there's certain things. The horns, you know, you really
with the glisses.
Yeah. The glissandos mm-hmm. and stuff in there, and so well, let's have a listen to it. This is Fire and Ice, the world premiere, by our very own Jim Hopson. Thank you. Wow, come on, that was a great ending. I mean, Jim, phenomenal job. I mean, that piece really, really was the perfect ending for this concert, I think. I mean, so there you have it, the VMO's Brass Through the Ages. I think this is a really fitting title for this concert. So, Jim, Mark, I just want to say thank you. And really, you guys have been so instrumental in putting this whole concert together. And I'm really pleased, and I'm really positive that this a concert will be enjoyed by everyone around the world. And this is one of the great things. I know we're all living through COVID-19, but one of the things we do have is we're actually reaching out to people abroad now, you know, and that's a great thing about doing something like this. So, Jim, thank you so much. I mean, is there anything you would like to say to the audience before we close up?
Just that it was such a great joy to work on this with you, Maestro, and Mark, to put together this program. I really do hope that the main thing that comes across from them watching this is how much fun we had.
Yes.
And how good it was for the soul to put this together.
Yeah. You know? And Mike?
I echoed Jim's sentiment. That I hope that they take away from that the spirit and the of the brass music, and also just the feeling that we're able to convey.
Yeah.
And also, I'm just really pleased that we're able to bring together all our friends, VMO friends,
and
play as a group, because the Metropolitan Orchestra hasn't had a chance to perform as much during this time, except for streaming. So, and I know with an organization like this, it's more difficult. You know, streaming revenues aren't the same as concert tickets.
It's not
tickets.
The same, yes. So, but you know, we like to still be reaching out to our friends and fans, mm-hmm. and essentially the VMO family. So, mm-hmm. So this is where, you know, I really want to say special thank you. I want to say special thank you. I think we should also credit not just only our fabulous musicians, but also the staff at the Chan Center who really kept us really safe. I mean, with the strict protocols for COVID-19. And so thank you both. Please stay safe and stay well. And we're going to be probably doing another recording session in the new year. So please be on the lookout. So thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being with us today. I hope you enjoyed the performance. I want to take this opportunity to, again, ask for your support to the Orchestra Society. We are all in times of need right now, and I really would like to be ensuring that we could be giving these musicians more opportunity to perform. Please consider a sponsorship or a donation. You can click on the link below, which will link you to www.bmocanada.com. You can look at our sponsorship package, or you can make a donation. And a donation of more than $20 will be issued a tax-deductible receipt. First of all, I would like to express a thank you to all the musicians. The musicians and I have enjoyed this opportunity to perform for you. We really do miss performing for you, and there's no doubt about that. You guys are a key reciprocal to our existence. Secondly, I would like to thank our sponsors and our donors. Without you, we wouldn't have had this opportunity to perform for you. And lastly, I would like to thank the volunteers. The volunteers who have spent so much time in ensuring that this concert takes place. Stay safe, stay well. I hope that we can be all together soon in a beautiful concert hall again. And we hope to see you again soon. Take care.